Good afternoon, folks. I know we've got participants still joining. Really glad to have you all with us. We are going to take just a couple minutes before we get started. We encountered a late-breaking tech challenge for one of our panelists. So bear with us for just another moment or two as we get this sorted out, and then we will be off to the races. Dr. Pear, can you hear us clearly now?
Yeah, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, wonderful. Okay. With that, then, let's go ahead and get started. So good afternoon, everyone. We are so glad you have joined us for this installment of our Lunch and Learn webinar series entitled Extreme Risk Protection Orders, Equity Considerations for Design and Implementation. I'm Luisa Aviles. I'm a senior program officer here at the Joyce Foundation in the Gun Violence Prevention and Justice Reform Program. And we're really thrilled to be joined today by Dr. Veronica Pear, who has resolved her late-breaking tech issues, much to our relief. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Emergency Medicine at the University of California, Davis. We're also joined by her colleague, Julia Schleimers, a research data analyst at UC Davis and a doctoral candidate in the Department of Epidemiology at the University of Washington. And finally, we are delighted to be joined by Sylvia Villarreal, the Director of Research Translation at the Center for Gun Violence Solutions at Johns Hopkins University. So before we get started, a couple quick bits of housekeeping. First, today's webinar is being recorded and in the coming days will be made available on the Joyce Foundation's website. Second, we expect to have at least 20 minutes for question and answer. So we encourage everyone to drop questions into the Q&A function. It's at the bottom of your screen. And please feel free to drop questions in even as the presentation is going on. We don't want you to lose your thought. And we'll get to all of the questions at the dedicated Q&A at the end. And finally, after today's discussion, we will share key materials referenced in today's webinar by email. So please keep an eye out for that. And if any of the presenters, you know, mention a key piece of research that you're interested in, please flag it for us in the Q&A and we'll make sure that it's included. So before I hand things over, I wanted to take a moment and just get us all on the same page with respect to the fundamentals of our topic. So extreme risk protection orders, also called ERPO policies, allow a court to temporarily remove firearms through a civil process from an individual who may be at risk of danger to themselves or others. As the use of ERPOs has increased in recent years, researchers and policymakers alike have begun to consider questions of equity and how communities perceive and use these orders. And this issue has become particularly timely as states consider how to apply for and use the $750 million over 5 years in new funding for ERPO implementation that's been made available under the Bipartisan Safer Communities Act. That solicitation is currently open and is closing in mid-December. So how to design and implement these policies is really at the forefront of a lot of policymakers' minds right now. We're particularly grateful to have Sylvia here with us to share as well about the Racial Equity and Gun Violence Prevention report that the Johns Hopkins Center co-authored with a number of other gun violence prevention organizations, and in the accompanying assessment tool that has been produced to guide the consideration of equity in just these circumstances. So with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Pear to get us started.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. And Julia, thanks for sharing the slides. So let's maybe just jump right into the background of this study that we'll be sharing with you today. Thanks. So those of you who are here probably know firearm violence is a substantial cause of morbidity and mortality in the United States, and its burden is not felt equally across populations. So firearm homicide is the leading cause of death for Black boys and young men who are more than 10 times as likely to die by this cause than their white counterparts. In addition, firearm suicide, which is typically concentrated among older white men, has been increasing more rapidly among Black youth than other racial ethnic groups. So legal policies can and should be used to prevent firearm violence, but I think extra care is needed to ensure that these laws aren't further entrenching racial disparities, since the criminal legal system has a long history of being used to perpetuate racist policies and reify racialized stereotypes about criminality. Given this reality, it's essential that firearm violence prevention policies and their implementation be examined through a racial equity lens. So extremist protection orders, or ERPOs, are a relatively new policy intended to prevent firearm homicide, suicide, and mass shootings. They're commonly known as red flag laws in the media. Formally in California, they're called gun violence restraining orders. And these different names have led to, I think, some confusion, but all of these different terms refer to the same thing. So ERPOs are a civil mechanism that temporarily prohibit the purchase and possession of firearms from people who are judged to be at particularly high risk of harming themselves or others. And so far they've been adopted by 19 states and the District of Columbia. And as Louisa mentioned earlier this year, the Bipartisan Safer Communities Act was passed, which allocated $750 million to states for implementation of ERPOs and similar laws. So additional states may be considering adoption as well. Next slide. California's ERPO law went into effect at the beginning of 2016. It was the first such law to be based on restraining orders rather than warrants, allowing for both the temporary removal of firearm and the prevention of new purchases. It also allowed for more types of people to serve as petitioners than earlier laws. Currently in California, we allow for families, household members, coworkers, school personnel, and law enforcement officers to petition a judge for an ERPO. And we have three types of ERPOs. So two are short-term orders lasting 21 days and only differing with respect to who can petition. And one is a long-term order lasting from 1 to 5 years. And typically an ERPO proceeds something like this. A precipitating event will occur, alerting others that a person is at high risk of firearm violence. This could be something like making a verbal suicide threat or pointing a gun at someone. And then someone else, usually a law enforcement officer, will petition a judge for a short-term order. And then if that's granted, it'll be served and the firearms will be removed immediately. After 21 days, a hearing will be held at which a judge will determine whether the respondent, that's the person who's the subject of the order, is at ongoing risk. And if they are, then the judge will issue a final order. After that order expires, the respondent can retrieve their firearms from wherever they're being held, typically a licensed firearm dealer or law enforcement agency, after passing a background check. So ERPOs are intended to prevent firearm violence by temporarily separating high-risk individuals from their firearms, but it's unclear whether the benefits and potential risks are shared equitably across racial ethnic groups. And early evidence about the use of ERPOs does raise some concerns about their equitable implementation. For example, several states, including California, have reported that a large majority of petitioners are law enforcement officers. And to the extent that members of marginalized communities are less inclined to contact law enforcement due to the long and ongoing history of racism and violence in the criminal legal system, ERPOs may be underutilized and their benefits unrealized in these populations. Underuse could also result if officers more often opt for arrests rather than ERPOs with minoritized individuals, which is of course at the officer's discretion. And at the same time, over-policing in communities of color, irrespective of actual crime rates, could result in overuse of ERPOs in these areas as a result of increased police contact. So it really could go either way. There could also be racial ethnic disparities in ERPO outcomes, such as arrests. Arrest at the time of ERPO service is most likely related to the crimes committed at the precipitating event, such as assault or brandishing a weapon. But it's also possible that respondents are being arrested for nonviolent or technical offenses as well, like parole violations. And these discretionary arrests are more likely to impact Black respondents due to historic, cultural, and structural racism. So we wanted to dig into this in this study. Here we sought to identify emerging signs of potential racial ethnic inequity in the perceptions and use of ERPOs in California by evaluating racial ethnic differences in the public awareness of and support for ERPOs and also in ERPO implementation. So Julia is going to talk about our methods.
Thanks, Veronica. So for this study, we use complementary data sources. The first was a state representative survey of California adults conducted in July 2020. And this is called the California Safety and Wellbeing Survey, or CSAWS for short. The second data source was ERPO court case files for the first 3 years of policy implementation from 2016 through 2018. For survey respondents, race ethnicity was self-reported. And for ERPO respondents, race ethnicity was derived from the ERPO petitions and therefore reported by the petitioner. However, law enforcement petitioners may obtain race ethnicity from respondents' state identification, which is self-reported. And I also want to just note explicitly that throughout, I'll be referring to survey participants as participants and ERPO respondents as respondents. So from CSAWS, we obtained data from participants on knowledge, attitudes, and personal willingness to use ERPOs among the general population of California. And questions about attitudes and willingness were asked in regard to five different risk scenarios, including when a person is experiencing an emotional crisis, has severe dementia or something like it, has threatened to physically hurt themselves, the participant or someone else, or a group of people. And from ERPO case files, we obtained detailed information on the case context and the ERPO processes among respondents. We used descriptive statistics stratified by race ethnicity, and survey data were weighted to be statistically representative of the adult California population. So on to some results. This shows the characteristics of the two samples. So the CSAWS 2020 sample was about 14% Asian, about 6% Black, 35% Hispanic or Latinx, 3.2% other race ethnicity, and almost 42% white. Of ERPO respondents, 10% were Black, 18% were Hispanic or Latinx, almost 8% were of another race or ethnicity, and about 64% were white. For ERPO respondents, Asian people were included in the other race ethnicity category to maintain adequate cell size. And about 2/3 of the other race respondents are Asian. In terms of awareness of ERPOs, most survey participants had actually never heard of the law. Awareness of the policy was notably lower among Black and Asian participants at about 77% and 79% respectively. And when we asked about perceived appropriateness, participants in all racial and ethnic groups were mostly supportive of ERPOs. However, Black and Hispanic or Latinx participants were relatively less supportive than others. For example, Black participants reported ERPOs were at least sometimes appropriate, 53.7% to 63.5% of the time, depending on the scenario. Whereas white participants said that ERPOs were at least sometimes appropriate, 79% to 87.6% of the time. And in all risk scenarios that we presented, most participants in all racial and ethnic groups reported being somewhat or very willing to personally ask a judge for an ERPO for a family member. However, again, Black participants were consistently the least willing compared with other groups. And not shown here, but Black participants were also the most likely to say they were not at all willing to ask a judge for an ERPO in all five scenarios that we presented. And Black participants were substantially less likely than others to say that they preferred to have police petition for an ERPO on their behalf. And this figure shows the distribution of reported reasons for unwillingness to personally petition for an ERPO among those who reported being not at all willing in one or more scenarios. And the reasons are listed on the left side or the y-axis. The percentages are on the x-axis, and the different racial and ethnic groups are indicated by the colored bars. Participants could select more than one reason as well. For almost all racial and ethnic groups surveyed, the most commonly cited reason for unwillingness to petition for an ERPO was not knowing enough about them. Among Asian, Black, and Hispanic or Latinx participants, this was by far the most common reason, cited by about 50% of those unwilling. Other common reasons for unwillingness were perceptions that risk is a personal or family matter, due process concerns, and not trusting the system to be fair. And now I'm going to turn it back to Veronica for the other results.
Okay. So getting to the abstracted court case records, I just first want to remind everyone that here we're dealing with pretty small cell sizes for all groups other than the white respondents. As you can see, Hispanic is 35 people, Black we have 20 people, and other race we only have 15 people. So we are dealing with small cells. And because of this, the findings here should be considered, I think, suggestive rather than definitive. So what we found was that Black respondents had the highest proportion of cases involving exclusively other directed threats, 85%, and white respondents had the lowest at 49%. Conversely, white respondents had the highest proportion of exclusively self-directed threats, 17%, and Black respondents had the lowest at 5%. Among cases involving threats to others, either alone or in combination with self-directed threats, intimate partners were a common target, ranging from 17% for Black respondents to 41% for Hispanic Latinx respondents. Access to firearms via either ownership or other means was most prevalent among Hispanic Latinx and white respondents, both around 94%. Conversely, 25% of Black respondents the portion among. And while firearm access isn't a requirement for an ERPO, I think this difference still feels notable. The most commonly reported risk factor for violence among white respondents was substance use, which included alcohol, present in 40% of cases. And for all other racial ethnic groups, loss of a loved one or relationship problems were the most common risk factors, ranging from 30% among Black respondents to 46% among Hispanic Latinx respondents. Finally, signs of paranoia, psychosis, and hallucinations were noted about twice as often in Black respondents as others. So we also looked at process details, and we found that the overwhelming majority of petitioners, again, were law enforcement officers, regardless of respondent race ethnicity. But it is worth noting that no family or household member served as the petitioner for a Black or Hispanic Latinx respondent in the first 3 years that the law was in effect in California. We also found that Black and Hispanic Latinx respondents were the most likely to be arrested at the time of ERPO service. We were concerned that this was confounded by the directionality of the threat, since other directed threats are more likely to involve a crime, and these type of threats were more common among Black and Hispanic Latinx respondents. So when we looked just at cases involving threats to others and then looked at arrest, these differences did narrow substantially, although they did persist. But again, I would say because these numbers are very small, I think we do need data before I think we can say arrest is definitely being applied, you know, in an inequitable way. So other police actions at the time of service included involuntary psychiatric holds, which we call 5150s in California. These were most common among white respondents, perhaps reflecting the higher proportion of self-harm threats in that group. We also found that the final orders were issued most often among Hispanic, Latinx, and other race respondents. Each were issued in about 60% of cases, and least often among Black respondents. Those were issued in about 40% of cases. In 45% of cases involving Black respondents, a final order wasn't sought at all. And finally, among those with an order after a hearing, Black respondents never had legal representation, whereas white respondents had representation in nearly a quarter of cases. This reflects the fact that respondents in California are not provided legal representation in civil court, unlike criminal court. The course has major equity implications, as only those with financial means to hire a personal attorney will benefit from their services. Getting access to wealth and financial resources is differential by race ethnicity due to structural racism and the systemic disinvestment in Black communities. It's no surprise to see this fundamentally economic disparity reflected in respondent race ethnicity. Okay, and back over to Julia.
Thanks. So to sort of sum up, we use complementary data sources in this study to provide some novel insights about who is likely to endorse and use ERPOs as a violence prevention tool, and who may experience their potential benefits and harms. Consistent with prior research and polling, our survey results show that large majorities of the general population and of all racial and ethnic groups consider ERPOs to be appropriate and would be willing to personally use them. However, despite this high level of support across the board, Hispanic, Latinx, and especially Black Californians perceived ERPOs as less appropriate and were less willing to personally use ERPOs, petition for ERPOs for a family member compared with most other groups. And Black survey participants were also least likely to say that they preferred to have police petition for an ERPO on their behalf. In turn, the ERPO case documents reinforced and extended some of these survey findings in several ways. For example, as Veronica mentioned, no Black or Hispanic Latinx respondents had a family or household member act as a petitioner. And together, these findings suggest that the family or household members of Black and Hispanic or Latinx individuals at risk for violence might be more hesitant than others to engage with the courts by petitioning for an ERPO directly, or to engage with police who might petition for them. And to ensure that ERPOs don't reinforce inequities, and to ensure that their benefits are equally distributed across all population subgroups, we need to better understand and address sources of racial and ethnic differences in support for and willingness to use ERPOs, which our study provides some indication about. Importantly, our study provides the basis for further investigation for some of these underlying reasons. For example, for almost all racial ethnic groups surveyed, the most common reason cited for unwillingness to petition for an ERPO was not knowing enough about them. And prior research has similarly found that lack of knowledge of ERPOs is a barrier to use among those who might petition. So engaging public health professionals, community-based organizations, and other frontline providers in educational and evaluation efforts could help remedy this knowledge gap and empower community members to participate in improving the policy themselves. Further, culturally affirming communication from trusted messengers may reduce stigma and perceptions that risk is a private or family matter, which was another common reason for unwillingness to use ERPOs among survey participants. In addition to educational interventions to promote policy awareness, our results also suggest a potential need for more institutional and structural reforms. The second most cited reason for Black Californians' lack of willingness to use an ERPO was not trusting the system to be fair. And indeed, a relatively low proportion of Black ERPO respondents had documented firearm access or were issued an order after hearing, which could indicate that the bar for issuing a temporary or emergency ERPO to Black individuals is a bit lower than that of other racial and ethnic groups. Black respondents also least often had legal representation, and Black and Hispanic Latinx respondents were most often arrested at the time of service. However, as Veronica mentioned, these differences in arrest were in part due to differences in the nature of the threat. While officers can't necessarily ignore criminal offenses, these findings nevertheless reinforce concerns that ERPOs can be used or can be exacerbating inequities by disproportionately enmeshing minoritized people in the criminal legal system. And importantly, we could not determine with our data whether ERPOs led to criminal charges or the other way around. But future research should examine whether and in what cases criminal charges are brought as a result of the ERPO, and whether these charges are pursued in lieu of the civil ERPO mechanism or related health and social services. In addition, white Californians also commonly cited concerns about the system not being fair. Also concerns about due process rights and risk being a personal or family matter, and that it was never appropriate for the government to take a person's guns. And consistent with some prior research, these findings suggest that individuals of different racialized identities relate to and perceive firearms and institutions that regulate them differently, with white people's lack of institutional trust perhaps rooted more in concerns over privacy and Second Amendment rights, whereas in contrast, Black and Hispanic or Latinx Californians' hesitation to use ERPOs may stem in part from experiences of inequity and racism, including in police violence, among many other harms. And notwithstanding the need for broader societal changes, there might be ways to decrease the likelihood of racial and ethnic inequities in the context of ERPOs specifically. And some of the areas for policy exploration here might include incorporating non-law enforcement behavioral health specialists in the process of ERPO service and firearm recovery. And with training, these teams could work alongside law enforcement to serve ERPOs and facilitate firearm recovery. They could also help connect respondents to social and behavioral health services, which might be important because respondents are often vulnerable to chronic risk factors for violence, such as untreated substance use, mental health problems, and employment or housing instability. So for ERPOs to have maximum life-saving impact, it will also be critical to fund the systems through which these services are provided and invest in the infrastructure to connect respondents across sectors. Secondly, court advocates and legal assistants could be made available to ERPO respondents and petitioners to help navigate the system and ensure that the rights of all parties are protected, regardless of race, ethnicity, or income. And importantly, for any of these efforts to succeed, impacted communities will need to be involved in all aspects of policymaking and implementation. Finally, and importantly, additional efforts are needed to continue monitoring the impact of ERPOs on racial equity and to address the structural roots of inequities and firearm-related harm more broadly. The study has several limitations, including that the survey may be subject to certain biases, such as social desirability bias, and it was also fielded during the COVID-19 pandemic, which may have an impact on the results. Regarding the ERPO respondent case files, we were not able to obtain all court records, and those that we did obtain may have had incomplete or inaccurate information, including because the records are from the perspective of the petitioner, often a law enforcement officer. We also had small cell sizes, especially for the analysis of court records. And our study is specific to California, and the findings might not generalize to other states. Lastly, the limited racial and ethnic diversity among our research team, which is mostly white, may have reduced our ability to center the point of view and experiences of minoritized groups. So we just like to acknowledge and thank our wonderful team of collaborators who are listed here. In addition, as you can see, this work was published earlier this year in Preventive Medicine. So please head over there if you'd like to read the paper in full, and the QR code here should link directly to the article, which is open access.
Thank you so much, Veronica and Julia. With that, I'm going to pass this over to Sylvia Villarreal from the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Solutions. I don't think we could have queued you up any better, Sylvia, to share a bit about the racial equity framework for gun violence prevention and related racial equity impact analysis tool that you were a part of helping to develop. So over to you.
Thank you, Lisa. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Okay, so hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here today and to have the opportunity to talk to you about our racial equity impact assessment tool and to share our work. So this is the outline of my presentation. It's very brief. Just so you know what to expect, I'm going to explain what the racial equity impact assessment tool is and how to use it. And I'm going to very briefly touch over the Colorado ERPO example that we included in our report. Before going into the details, what is a racial equity impact assessment? And I think that is the most important question of my presentation today. But before we go into that, I'd like to give you a little bit of context about how we created this tool. So this project was developed by the Educational Fund to Stop Gun Violence before we merged into Johns Hopkins with DC Justice Lab. And we did it in partnership with organizations like Cities United, March for Our Lives, Community Justice Action Fund, and the Consortium for Risk-Based Firearm Policy. So it was 7 authoring organizations in total. And we realized that there was an urgent need to advance racial equity within the gun violence prevention movement. So we looked at the data and realized that the lack of racial equity considerations had a huge impact on the health and well-being on the communities that were really most impacted by gun violence. So we developed this tool by comparing and analyzing other racial equity impact assessments, 8 in total, from other areas of work like domestic violence. And once we had those inputs, we organized a series of convenings with a diverse group of stakeholders, researchers, experts on community-based interventions, leaders on health, and racial equity and policy, and use those insights from those discussions as inputs to create the 9 questions of our REIA. That's how we call it. So it is also important to note here that to reach an agreement on what this tool would be, all participants created a series of values to guide these discussions. So these are our values. Just recognizing that gun violence takes many forms and it impacts communities in different ways. Recognizing that race is a human developed construct that assigns different values to groups, that it's not based on biology. Recognizing that no racial group is more violent than others. Recognizing that, and this is really important, that lived experience is just as important to gun violence research as scholarships and credentials. So all expertise is valuable to prevent violence. And lastly, recognizing that the development of racially equitable policy cannot happen without confronting systemic racism. So what is a racial equity impact assessment tool? The REIA is a tool that helps us identify and assess factors that are related to racial equity that should be considered before the policy is implemented. So assessing these factors gives us the opportunity to consciously think about and avoid unintended negative effects, such as victimizations, arrests, and incarcerations, before the policy is fully developed. But REIAs can also be used on existing policies because it can help us guide the implementation process of a particular policy like ERPO's and suggest amendments of racial equity issues that we might have found or identified. So how to use the REIA? Ideally, using it should be a team process within, but also beyond the organization. So it is important to connect with partners to find that diversity of perspectives and voices within your organization, but also beyond it. So the people or the team doing the project can create a more holistic assessment. The REIA requires really careful consideration of 9 questions. And each of the answers, I'm going to show you the 9 questions in a moment. I'm creating a lot of suspense. But each of the answers to these questions will help guide organizations as they decide to move forward with the policy or support it or change it or advocate for it, while also considering what is the risk of inaction? Like, what is the risk if I don't support this? So the final answer that you come up with after using the REIA, it's going to really depend on the values and the goals of each organization that uses this tool. But something that I would like to highlight is that the tool is a guide. It is a decision-making tool. So it needs to be consulted. It's a living document. It needs to be updated frequently as new data and research becomes available or as circumstances around the policies or the context around communities change. So these are the 9 questions of our REIA tool. I'm not going to read them out loud, but the first 4 questions are about the policy and data itself. So to answer them, we need to take a dive into the policy language and what issue is trying to solve, how data shows the racial disparities that are identified. So within our REIA tool and the report is really just like an explanation and a lot more resources on how to use this tool. We included an applied example of how to use this tool using Colorado's Extreme Risk Protection Order statute. So, and that example was done by our legal staff, but really the tool is designed so that anyone from different disciplines can use it. And it really is going to depend on the capacity and the resources of the organization doing the REIA. So those are the first questions. If we go further in question number 4, who are the communities most impacted? We recognize, well, using the Colorado ERPO example, that ERPOs can apply to anyone in Colorado who might legally possess firearms. However, individuals who are at risk of suicide or prone to mental health or behavior crisis were more likely to experience ERPOs than the general public. So our team, while doing this assessment, talked to the primary sponsors of the Colorado ERPO law just to know what their external engagement process was, which counties participated, which community-based organizations were part of this process. And beyond the external engagement, we found out that the primary sponsors of this bill in Colorado also worked closely with the Black and Latino caucuses, who in turn are directly engaged with their community and have a lot more resources and connections with impacted communities. They were able to get input and feedback on this legislation from those communities. So I think this is a key aspect of any policy process. By engaging opponents and proponents of the legislation and expanding the usual stakeholder network through partnerships, policymakers or advocates can have a more holistic outreach strategy. So if we move forward, question 6 and 7 are about the potential racial inequities. And in the case of Colorado, there was not a lot of data available yet, but preliminary assessments of the issuance of ERPOs were promising and did not show signs of misuse. So all in all, there was no current legal alternative to ERPOs that presented a lower risk to racial equity than ERPOs. And lastly, the last 2 questions, 8 and 9, focus on the road ahead. So in our example, AIRPOS appear to be viable and sustainable means of preventing potential firearm deaths and injuries. They require a few judicial resources and little cost. And in reality, stakeholder education was the largest obstacle to implement it effectively. And I think that's consistent with what Julia and Veronica were saying before. Because at the end of the day, AIRPOS are only useful if they are used, which will not happen if law enforcement or community members do not know what an AIRPO is or how it can be used to prevent gun violence, or if there are not assigned resources to support its implementation. So these 9 questions are our tool. Our Colorado example is a lot more extensive than what I'm sharing here, but you can find the tool, the report, and the example on our webpage. I can, or Luisa can, share the link with you all. So this is my email, so feel free to reach out if you have questions. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen now.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. And with this, we'll open it up to questions. And you see we have a few here in the Q&A. Please feel free to drop others in as they come to you. But I really appreciate it. For folks that I haven't met, I am comparatively new to the broader gun violence prevention policy landscape, having spent a great deal of time in the community violence intervention space. And one of the things that struck me about AIRPO policy is sort of where you ended, Sylvia, which is the flexibility of a tool like this to fill a gap around safely removing firearms in a context where there may be a lot of other factors going into the extent of to which someone at risk wishes for there to be involvement in the criminal legal system. And we don't necessarily think of AIRPOs in that context always, but it's something that's really struck me. And so I've appreciated the lens that you all have brought to this. So with that, I'm gonna start just moving some questions from our chat function around here to you all. I'm gonna add a couple of these together. We have a couple of questions with respect to firearms removal, and particularly in California, whether a home is searched when a firearm is to be removed, and if the person is a minor, are firearms removed from their home, or does that extend to their parents' firearms? So I'll pass that to Veronica and Julia, whichever of you would like to take that question.
Sure. So firearms, I think the officers will first request that the firearms are voluntarily relinquished. And if that doesn't happen, then typically they'll get a search warrant. When we did qualitative interviews with officers, they were saying that they prefer to get, I think they call them a trigger search warrant. So basically it's signed ahead of time, and it's like if it's contingent, right? So like if the person doesn't agree to voluntarily surrender their firearms, then the search warrant goes into effect and you can search the home. And in terms of the minor issue, so are firearms removed from the parents in these cases? I think this is actually something that different areas kind of deal with differently. I mean, we are seeing AIRPOs used against minors in California and in other states. And I think typically if there are firearms, you know, they don't belong to the minor, they belong to the parents. My understanding is that the sort of first request is that the parents lock up the firearms and sort of, you know, remove access that way. But if the parents don't agree to that type of action, then they will be removed from the house.
Of other questions related to stakeholder education, particularly both of these questions are, or one of these questions is with respect to law enforcement and particularly sheriffs and city police, and then a broader question from New York about how best to do that stakeholder education, and noting that there are disparities in how the just numerical disparities and how often the policies are used in urban versus rural settings. Can you all speak a little bit, I'm not sure who wants to take this, but can you all speak a little bit to what some of the perhaps implications of these findings are for how to engage stakeholders and how to think about the different, potential contextual factors that stakeholders, like whether law enforcement or otherwise, ought to be aware of and thinking about how that, you know, their role in this, the process of implementing a policy like this.
Do you want to take that, Julia?
Sure. So our findings pointed to some reasons underlying people's sort of hesitation to use ERPOs. And that I think really understanding that in more depth and detail is going to be important for different folks of different races and ethnicities and also different roles in the process. So we, and that includes law enforcement officers and others who might petition. So in California, only a handful of groups can petition. That varies a little bit state to state, including in some others where healthcare professionals can petition. So really learning about what folks think about the policy, what their potential barriers to use are, and then also really shining a light on potential racial and ethnic inequities in ways that people might not have thought of before. So in very early in the process, when we were doing, as Veronica just mentioned, qualitative interviews with folks responsible for implementing the policy in California, one of the questions we asked about was, do you think there is potential for this policy to further racial inequities or be used inequitably? And I remember one of the people in that study responded essentially no, because the policy is being used mostly for white people. And that sort of misses the broader point that these policies can save lives. And so if they're being used only for, you know, mostly for white people, then those benefits are not realized by other populations.
Can I roll right into that? You know, I think that that rolls right into another question that's come up here, which is around concerns, you know, if one of the potential equity considerations that's highlighted by your research is that given historical experience with law enforcement and criminal legal institutions, Black and Hispanic and other racialized, you know, minoritized populations might be hesitant to engage with those systems if that's the primary route to accessing a policy like this. We have a question in the chat about, you know, whether those same concerns might extend to healthcare providers. There are a number of states that have made healthcare providers, you know, possible petitioners for ERPO. And I think that's a really, I wonder if Sylvia, you want to take this, because I think that is a really interesting question that gets to the utility of a tool like the racial equity impact analysis tool, because I think that's, you know, a really excellent question with respect to just how, you know, being sensitive to how institutions are viewed by different groups in different states and different contexts, and what, you know, bearing that might have for how a policy is shaped in a particular community or state. So Sylvia, do you want to speak a little bit to that particular concern about how, you know, ERPO might be, how folks might or might not be, you know, interested in engaging with healthcare providers to access an ERPO policy?
Yeah, so one thing that I think it's particularly important to note is that impacted communities or minoritized communities that are affected by gun violence are different in every state. And even like potential racial inequities from ERPOs in California are going to be different from the potential racial inequities in Colorado, which is because like there's a lot of Latino communities in California. So you have, I think we need to consider like what are the aspects of why, first of all, they are not comfortable using them, and to provide other mechanisms. So I think the example that we used in Colorado, different people other than law enforcement can petition. So I think that's really helpful. So I wonder if we can just like expand on that on different states. It could be a good alternative to solve this sort of issues with law enforcement and trust around communities.
Can you say, Sylvia, since we're on you, can I stay on you for a moment? Can you say a little bit more about how this tool was developed and what the process was for incorporating voices from communities disproportionately impacted in the tools development?
So as I mentioned during our presentation, so we engaged a lot of researchers and leaders and experts, and many of the authoring organizations, Community Justice Action Fund, Cities United, DC Justice Lab, are community-based organizations. So I think having their perspective, that it's just not focused on research or academics, was very useful on first setting our core values on how we were going to define these questions. And also, like, after the convenings, we added a whole process of feedback from a lot more racial equity experts and leaders in policy and health to just take a look at what the work that we were doing. So I think even though it was a very complex process, it made it it made it stronger overall.
I'm gonna jump back over to California. And I appreciate this question because I just saw that the San Diego City Attorney's Office filed their 1,000th successful ERPO, or GVRO as they're called in California policy. So the question asking whether most of the cases reviewed for this study were from that office in San Diego, so disproportionately used, you know, made use of ERPO as a tool. So Veronica and Julia, can we send that to you all?
Yeah, so actually I don't have this off the top of my head. I believe that San Diego ERPOs were a plurality, but they weren't a majority. So they didn't cross that 50% threshold to be a majority. But yeah, certainly I think they cases from San Diego were the most prevalent. So I would say also that, you know, obviously if the specific practices that they use in San Diego are definitely being overrepresented. Like, for example, I do know that they often combine them with arrest intentionally to sort of cover that period in which a person may get out on bail and have access to a firearm. So, you know, sort of specific practices like that might not generalize to other parts of the state.
Can I pose this to all three of you, whoever would like to sort of jump in first? So it strikes me that there are a couple of big picture takeaways from the combination of presentations here. One is that there are, you know, it is very sensible and perhaps even our collective obligation to really consider this policy and other approaches to gun violence prevention through policy and law through a racial equity lens and to be sensitive to that. And I think it's the Hopkins et al. Who contributed to the racial equity framework, I think have done the rest of us a service by creating those tools and making them accessible and walking us through it. And that said, you know, now that the research that you all have started in California on equity considerations, now that you see some of the, you know, potential points where there could be inequities and how the policy is implemented, do you have suggestions or thoughts about, you know, the particular lines of research or particular findings that you'd like to unpack further to clarify, you know, what the impact of those, you know, seeming disparities could actually be, or suggestions, you know, with respect to, you know, potential policy implications that policymakers should be attentive to, given these sort of early flags that, you know, this might not be an area of concern, but it could be. And so how do we, you know, how ought policy be considered? So both sort of what's the potential, you know, what's the wish list of research that you'd like to do to dig into some of these? And, you know, what are sort of the top line items that you'd encourage policymakers to consider given some of these areas that you're pointing to?
Yeah, I would say in terms of research, what I am really excited about and looking forward to in this space now is doing qualitative work. So I think speaking to the respondents is going to be a really important piece that we're just sort of getting underway in partnership with Hopkins, actually. And, you know, just asking people, what was your experience like? What were the consequences, maybe intended and unintended? And also, I think speaking to maybe in focus groups with members of especially impacted communities of all types, not only Black and Brown communities, but also I think we should be talking to rural communities, to Native American communities, asking what do you think about these laws? What are your concerns? What would make you sort of more open to using them, if anything? So I think really, yeah, we're to the point where we need to be talking to people to see, you know, what those folks are saying themselves. And then in addition, tracking these sort of numeric differences over time. We did the first 3 years here. I think the longer this policy is in effect, the greater sort of power we'll have to detect actual differences and not be stuck with these very small cell sizes.
And I'll just add briefly along those lines, after and in, throughout the whole process of engaging more directly with communities and in this deeper sort of qualitative dive, taking what we learned from that and seeing how we can be creative with policy modification and implementation. So if there are ways that communities say, I think this or that would be really helpful and would increase the likelihood that I or folks in my community would use this tool and that would it would promote safety in this way, doing pilot sort of studies and maybe changing things in different places and seeing what happens and really building the research out that way.
And just to add to the comments from Veronica and Julia, one thing that we found when we were doing the Colorado example was just that there was not enough demographic data available from courts. So I think that is an area of opportunity. And also the other thing is that race and ethnicity from this court information is it's self-reported. So we have data, facial data, but generally with minoritized communities or with communities of color, data is only half the picture. So what Veronica was saying before, just like adding focus groups and interviews and more qualitative aspects to this data and research, I think will be very valuable on the road ahead of how we assess AIRPOS.
In that vein, I apologize, everyone. You may be getting some sirens on my end. So if you can't hear them, ignore me. If you can, I apologize, and someone throw a flag if it's too distracting. So we have time for probably one more question. And I also want to just lift up some notes in the chat about ways in which future research might consider the impact on not just victims, but families and communities if AIRPOS are or aren't sought. And there's a particular note here about, what the impact, the economic impact on a family or household could be. So I think that is a great question. And so lastly, Veronica, Julia, could you just say just very quickly a little bit about the ways in which the California landscape is different from other states with respect to the number of mechanisms that are available akin to AIRPOS?
Yeah, well, so California has very stringent firearm laws. We have lots of different mechanisms for people even having temporary prohibitions. Obviously, domestic violence restraining orders are available for IPV cases, and we have different other types of restraining orders that also have a firearm removal component that might be appropriate as well. In addition to those different restraining orders, we just have additional prohibitions that are longer lasting against firearm purchase as well, like violent misdemeanors carry a prohibition, for example. Julia, do you have anything else to add?
There's also the 5150 mechanism, though other states have something similar. But yeah, I think you covered it. So that sort of can influence how the policy is being used. Fewer people might be needing an AIRPO essentially, and mm-hmm. the options for alternatives might be different.
Right. And actually, I think that's one really cool thing about AIRPOS is that they're very flexible. So in California, right, we have all these other policies. So maybe our gaps are smaller than other states. Like if you can think about Florida, for example, where they're really using AIRPOS a lot. And maybe that has something to do with the fact that they have, bigger gaps when it comes to firearm access. So anyway, that's an aside. I think that's one really great aspect of this law is that it can be flexible and suit different states as needed.
I think that's a great place to end, because I think also inherent to the flexibility of the core policy is the idea that there's a lot of room around design and implementation to think specifically about the equity considerations that might be relevant in a particular community, which then gets back to the value of the racial equity impact analysis tool in very particular and perhaps very local policy context to, you know, consider the particular communities impacted, the particular gap that this policy is filling, and, you know, the opportunities to be really sensitive to equity concerns, you know, around what, you know, encouraging the pursuit of an ERPO when appropriate, and also what the impacts could be if it's not accessible. So I want to just, you know, on that note, thank you all tremendously for joining us today. And a special thank you to our three panelists for this research and for making themselves available to discuss it. We will be posting the recording of this webinar on the Joyce Foundation website and also sending around a follow-up email to link to these resources and documents. And we saw a couple notes in the chat about other resources that were mentioned. We'll make sure to include those as well. And while I have everybody, I also want to make sure folks are aware of two other upcoming webinars. One is next Thursday, December 15th at 12 p.m. Central, discussing the policy agenda for 2023 and beyond in Illinois around reducing gun violence. And the second is in January, on January 18th at 12 p.m. Central, a discussion around the use of federal funding to support community violence intervention programs. And so we will be including more information about those webinars in our follow-up email as well. And again, thank you all so much for joining us on your lunch hour. And we now release you back to your workday and look forward to seeing many folks on our next webinar. Thanks so much, everyone.